I want to make some corrections regarding yesterday's lecture. So we introduced language parameters. So they are homomorphisms, as we also heard this morning, from the language group. L group, and then I want to introduce a notion of phi being essentially discrete. If the centralizer not the center. Gamma invariant part of the center of the check is fine. And then I had a lemma where we said phi is discrete if and only if the image of phi is not contained in any proper parabolic. So what I want you to know is that this is not correct. It should be essentially discrete. And the second thing is that I gave the impression that this trick or method to have a coherent introduction or definition of the Haar measure for all inner forms of a given group. By using some top form, that this is due to Gross, or that this is a recent result, but this is not, of course. This is something that was around at least, as Bender mentioned to me, since the paper of Jacques in England. Also, Weil certainly knew this, and when you study the Tamagawa measures, certainly to do this kind of constructions. So, but in any case, in the paper of Gross, it is described nicely. Alright, so so today I will start by so I hear myself twice. Is it okay? That sounds as good. Okay. So today I will introduce the L functions associated to a language parameter. So given language parameter, and a representation suppose we have a representation, so we would like to assign L functions, epsilon factors, to representations of the language group. And so these are certain neuromorphic functions of a parameter S. Thank you. And they are characterized by what the value is on a character. So and then a certain inductiveness and additivity. Additivity means that if you have a direct sum of two representations, then the assigned function will be the product of the values at the two summands. And what we call inductiveness so this means that so this is in the in zero for epsilon factors. And this means that so suppose that you have a subfield. And then you can look at the L function you want to attach to the induced representation of, let's say, some character from the L group of F to the L group of F prime. And this should be the same as the L function attached to chi, where chi is a character. And so in degree zero means that this is true for virtual representations. In fact, if you do not put here a character with a representation which has degree zero, then we say it's inductive in degree zero. And so essentially it's known that, or it is known that these things are determined by these properties. And of course knowing the value at the calculus. So let's do this for the L functions. They are the most important for us. So let's do first the Archimedean case. So if f is c, then, well, so the B group of f is then just c cross. And then if we want to write an arbitrary character, we can write it as follows. Chi of z is sigma z, so sigma is an automorphism of z to the power minus n. Here n is non-negative, times the norm of z. You go to the real field to the power s, so I can write characters uniquely in such a way, and then the L function, or let's make this s zero, so the L function of s chi in this case is given by 2 times 2 pi to the minus s plus the zero times the gamma function. If f is the real field, well then the abelianized, so then the W group is the multiplicative group of the quaternions. And the abelianized W group is the invertible real numbers. And so then the characters of this guy can be written in the form something like x to the minus n, absolute value of x to the s, where n is 0 or 1, uniquely, and then the L function is pi to the minus s plus s 0 over 2, gamma s plus s 0 over 2. And then for the other case, so there are not that many irreducible higher dimensional representations. Of course, in the complex case, this is abelian, so there are only complex. So I told you basically everything here. And here there are also two-dimensional representations, but with Mackey theory you see that they are always induced. And induced from the Weyl group of C. And
it's not there.
Excuse me?
The exponent there is not.
Thank you very much. Yes. And so in that case you can use the inductive property to compute it. So basically this is all you need to know. And then
what is h star? What is WF equals h star? What is that h?
The quaternions, the multiplicative
abelian asked.
No, H. What is H? Is the quaternions?
Quaternions, yes.
But that's not the usual Weyl group.
Excuse me?
It's not the usual Weyl group of R. It's C star semi direct product yet more 2.
Yeah, but that's the same thing, right? So we have a C cross union C cross J and
that H star is a four-dimensional group, yeah. That is a two-dimensional group.
Right. Oh, this is four-dimensional real.
No. C star, no. Union J C star.
Ah. Okay. good. So C cross union J C cross.
J is equals minus 1.
And then the rules are that the J Z J Z bar and J square is minus 1. Okay, but still this the rest makes sense. So let's see. For the Pierre case. Then I can just give a formula. Anne-Marie explained about the Frobenius element in the Weyl group. So we have this defining signals for the Weyl group. And we have a splitting and the image of a generator in the Frobenius here. And then here Q is, as usual, the cardinality of the residue field, and we put Frobenius tilde in LF, is Frobenius, comma, and then the semi-simple element in SO2 of this form. And then the L function on any representation of is given by the formula determinant of 1 minus Q2 minus S. And then you take the image of the Frobenius tilde. And now, we take the invariance under the inertia, and then this there is an action of this element independent of the chosen method. But then we take also only the highest wave vectors, because this is still an SO2 module. So now we take n. So n is in SL2. So we have an algebraic SL2 representation, so I can talk about the action of this element in the Lie algebra. We take the highest wave vectors for those, and then we take the reciprocal of this polynomial. So that is the definition. And I can write this also as follows. It's the product determinant 1 minus Q to the minus S minus N over 2. And then the ordinary Frobenius no tilde restricted to n little n I inverse where I decompose V as a representation of this product in irreducibles of the both the factors, so it is the sum n bigger equal zero Vn tensor is the n plus one dimensional representation of SL2, which I write as sim n. And Vm here is then a representation of the wave. And so if you work out this formula, then you get exactly this expression. And then there are epsilon factors. They will not play such a big role for us. So if F is non-Archimedean, then the epsilon vector S V psi, psi is this chosen additive character, is epsilon of we twist. So this is in the notation of Tate. In his Corvallis notes, number theoretic background, which is a very good account of this. And this can be written in a form, it's some constant times the power of Q, which involves something of this form. It's a half minus S times some integer, and this integer is related to the arcing conductor of the representations Vn of the wave. It's some, so you can look it up. What it is exactly, but for us it is not so important, so I will just skip it. And for F is R or C, then the epsilon vectors are the following kind. So it is, well, if we take V as a character, and again we write it in the standard form, so norm x to the s and z to the minus n norm z to the s. So this is in the real case. This is in the complex case. Then it is some power of I to the m, where that is this m, times some constant, which depends on our additive character. Okay, so that is a lot of definitions of important invariants attached to representations of the Weyl group. Now, we want to use Langmuir's parameter in order to create representations of the Weyl group, and well, then you can compose it, of course, with the representation of the L group, and we will have a particular attention for the case where this representation of the L group is the adjoint representation. So, definition given the Langlands parameter phi, define the adjoint gamma factor of this parameter, denoted by gamma S, adjoint composed with S psi. So this is now a representation of LF on the dual Lie algebra. And it's the epsilon vector, this representation, times L 1 minus S divided by L of S. So here are the L functions and epsilon vectors that we introduced, and this particular quotient will play a major role in this conjecture of Iraga, Chino, and Ikeda. So there is a proposition which is important here. Namely, if you look at the L function, then it is regular at S is 0, if and only if phi is a discrete parameter. And about the proof, well, in one direction, this is rather easy. So, so if the L function is regular at zero, it's well known that this cannot contain a trivial representation. Excuse me? I did. It means that the centralizer is fine. So yesterday I defined it. So the centralizer in the check of the image of phi is fine. And so if this is irregular, then it cannot be that this representation contains the trivial representation. And that, of course, is equivalent to the fact that the centralizer, which is a finite group, has to be, no, the centralizer, which is a reductive group, is discrete. So this is clearly the condition that this is true. I mean, after all, this is the adjoint action. So this is. In the other direction, well, it's related to the exercise I ended with yesterday. So, so for FPNIC, first proof that phi is discrete implies that the image of the A group is finite. And that is the same as saying that the image of the Frobenius is a finite order element. Excuse me?
Centralizer of field. Centralizer. Centralizer of the image.
No, I mean here that the image of the day loop is a finite. So a priori we know that the image of the inertia group is a finite group, but in general the Frobenius is mapped to a semi-simple element. But for a discrete parameter, this semi-simple element has to have finite order. And this also shows exactly that the discrete parameter will have a bounded image of the wave group, which was the definition of temperedness, right? So this is the exercise in the plastic. But so once you know that, you can easily use the formula I just erased, where you have this product over positive n or non-negative n of the L functions related to the Vn. So I decomposed V, which is now my G check as a sum Vn times sin m as a representation of the Langmuir's group. And well, the fact that the image of the Frobenius is finite order, so it has only groups of unity as eigenvalues. And looking at this formula easily shows that in the Piano case, the converse implication is done. So this is an exercise. And in the real and complex case, well, in the complex case, there are no discrete parameters. And in the real case, that's also an interesting exercise, which I will leave to you. But really, you need to analyze a little bit the different representations you have in G-check. Okay, I will not go into that. All right, so as a corollary of this statement, we get that if we have a discrete Langmuir's parameter, then this expression, the gamma factor associated with the parameter, is regular and non-zero at S to zero. And well, that follows really easily once you know this by looking at the formulas given in this exercise. But you will see which role this plays. Because essentially this should represent the formal degree of the corresponding discrete series of that parameter. So it's better that we know in advance we have this regularity and non-vanishing. Okay, so then I want to talk a little bit about the parametrization of tempered representation by Langmuir's parameters, at least the conjectural parameters. Then especially the enhanced parameters. So, because a parameter in general corresponds not to just one representation, but to a whole packet of representations. And we need to, in order to formulate conjecture precisely, we need to specify this. So put phi of g for the set of admissible inducible representations of G So then the global Langlands correspondence, as was also discussed by Anne-Marie, states that there should exist a partition with very nice properties. Over this set IOG, over the set of equivalence classes of Langlands parameters in certain packets, pi phi of g. So here phi Langlands. And in any case, what should hold for this partitioning? Is that I tempered should correspond to the phi such that the class of pi belongs to pi phi, of course, is tempered. And pi essentially L2 should correspond to phi essential discrete. Okay, so let us formulate the conjecture about the parametrization. The tempered packets. And so, in fact, I will restrict myself here to the So we introduce G simply connected check. So this is the simply connected cover of the derived group of G check. And G natural is just the dual group of G mod A, and recall from yesterday that A is the in the center the maximal split torus, maximal split compound. And G check but is the simply connected divided out by the center of it. So that is the dual, well, you can imagine it by yourself. You can see that, of course, as the dual group of the simply connected cover of the derived group. So now we consider the following diagram. So we have G check natural, so that maps to G check out. And also the G check simply connected maps to that. So now, given a Langlands parameter, to LG tempered for G, we define the S natural. Fine. As well, the centralizer in G-check natural, so this is S in G-check natural, int S phi is phi, and the curly version of this, I hope it's clear in my handwriting, is the component group of this. And so that guy is here. And so now we take the image under alpha and the pre-image under beta. So I define the S phi is the beta inverse alpha of S phi natural. And the component group of that guy is again with a curly letter. So now there is, so suppose we have some G, connecting the reductive, and so that is an inner form of the group G star, the quasi state element in the class, and so this gives me a class, a Galois cohomology class in adjoint of G star. And now there is a theorem due to properties, which is all over the place in this business. So there is a canonical bijection between the H1 of this group and the character group of the center. So the home of the center of the simply connected version of so this guy. To C plus. So you can also write this as the simply connected center and then take the gamma inheritance. Sorry, so that is the first argument in this form. So it's the Pontryagin dual of that. And now there is a lemma which says that things work well with respect to these classes and taking the component groups. So it's a lemma due to Kiraga and Saito. So that IG in this Pontryagin dual of the center of the L group be the class corresponding to G character. Via this Gottwitz map, then the kernel of chi G contains the intersection of the center with the connected component of S phi. So that implies that this character descends to a character of the image of the center of the L group into S5. So that's the center here. And here we have the, no, the S5 also is here. The center is certainly mapped into that. And we call that also IP. And now we extend this because well, we need to do this so carefully because otherwise we get too many enhanced parameters. So we need to extend this from the gamma invariance of the center to the full center. And this can be done. So choose a lift of this IG to the image of the center in SG, such that still the G star, so the quasi state form, is corresponding to a trivial character. And then we define a set of parameters which should parameterize this packet corresponding to this parameter. So the parameters are, so we have this character corresponding to G, and now we are looking at all the representations of S phi, which live in this big covering. But we want that if you restrict this irreducible character to the image of this center, then it is a multiple of the character associated to G. So this distinguishes the enhanced parameters that you attach to the various spin-off forms. And so now the conjecture, conjectural parametrization of the packet is such that there exists a bijection between pi g phi and this set that I just introduced, s phi phi g. Such that for all phi, if you look at the sum over the members, dimension of rho, and then take the distributional character of pi rho, that is the unique, and this we should sum over the H1, is the unique stable character well, essentially unique up to the scalar in the packet. Well, that is a lot to digest.
Sorry, what is n in the last line?
Excuse me?
What is n in the third line of the...
Ah, yes, so n is just... I mean, I just... If you restrict, it has to become... you get the scalar action of this set. And so I
dimension of...
So it's the dimension of the parameter. So I guess there should be a very simple answer to this. So it's just the dimension of these rules. Okay, so now let's formulate the conjectures.
The sum about H1 is about which dimension? Yes, you take this sum and
so I sum over all the inner forms.
Yes.
And then for each inner form, I take this packet, the corresponding parameters, and then I take these parameters.
And the packet is for itself.
Excuse me?
And the packet phi g is fixed, yes.
Yeah,
I think you need not have taken the external sum.
Yeah.
Maybe I should not take this external sum. So it should be the component of the stable distribution corresponding to G, which is just a distribution on G.
Okay.
So I think that is better to say it like that. Okay, so I fully agree. I want it. So now the conjectures, let's try to formulate them. So there are two. So conjecture one. So let phi be discrete Langmuir parameter. And the rho is in this parameterizing set. And pi in the packet corresponding to the discrete series corresponding to rho, then the form of degree of pi should be the dimension of rho over the size of S natural. So this is why we need it also as a natural. And then the gamma factor at zero not composed in phi psi. There, this is with respect to the Heisenberg Joseph Constein. And the second one is in fact a natural consequence of this first one using conjecture of Shahidi, how to express the Poincaré densities in terms of Shahidi L functions. You combine that with this formula for the formal degree, you naturally arrive at the following. So that P is Mn be a semi-standard. F parabolic that O be an orbit of essentially discrete series characters of M under the group of unitary unremified characters of M, and for pi in this orbit put the d mu Poincaré pi, well this is then the let's not yet put the pressure on. So put d nu pi is dimension rho over the S 5 n. So that phi m be corresponding Langlands parameter for m for this essentially distant series. And then we take the gamma factor, and then we take the representation phi m composed with rm, I will tell you in a minute what this is, times d pi. And here, so d pi is simply the normalized Lebesgue measure. On O, O has the, is just the torus, compact torus. And rm is the adjoint representation of Ln on G hat, G check modulo the center of M hat. Ah, the gamma invariant. So this defines another representation with respect to which we have gamma. So this is, and then the statement is, sorry, I didn't finish the sentence, that the Poincaré measure at pi is some constant times this, what I just wrote down, for Cm, some rational number, independent. And these rational numbers are harmless. Easy to find those. Okay, so that is the formulation of the two conjectures. So really, as promised, expressing the Poincaré density, and in particular the formal degree of discrete series in terms of the expected Langlands parameters. So let me say something about the results. So what is known? And we have some comments. So the conjecture is known. Conjectures are known. For f is r, and let's see. So this is already in the paper of the three authors, and this is a verification if you know Archimedes' formula. Okay. Then for f periodic, so what is known? And I think I want to restrict myself to one now, is known for G is inner form of DNN. That's by Silver's A. Known for inner forms SL by Hiraga and Saito. That's quite recent. It's for the Steinberg representation. It was known for a long time. G-split exceptional. And pi unipotent discrete series, that was the result of Rieger. And for depth zero, supercuspidals by Gross. And then more recently there is a result of Icino Lapid Mao. They prove it for in general for SO odd. And those are guesses. We use it for unit angles. So it's quite a list. So the result I want to explain, I can, in the rest of these lectures, is the following. So here is the theory, the main theory. So the conjectures one and two hold for G absolutely simple, such that G splits over an unrelified extension of F for unipotent. I will talk about unipotent representations later, but let me make the statement. If we assume Lustig's parameters for these unipotent representations to be the Langlands parameters. So Lustig gives, in terms of unramified, so this will be unramified Langlands parameters. So he gives, in terms of unramified Langlands parameters, a classification of the unipotent representations, but he never says. He claims that this is the Langlands. These are the Langlands parameters, and also so all the properties that should be satisfied is lie in harmonic analysis, lie rather far from these geometric methods. So, but he gives a parametrization. But if we assume his parametrization as the Langlands parametrization, then we do get indeed that these two conjectures hold. And in fact, this characterizes the parameterization. In fact, this essentially characterizes this parameterization. So essentially means up to automorphisms. Okay, that's it for today. Thank you.
sure that this parameterization is coincide with the long lost ones.
No. No, no. So, what I'm saying is that if I take Lustig's parameterization,
yes,
then these conjectures hold. Because you need to attach representations to parameters in order to formulate even conjectures.
And if you twist Lustig parameterization by some involution, for instance, it would be okay.
Yes, so certain out of but this is already inherent in the Lustig parameterization.
Yes.
Because Lustig obtains this parameterization by identifying diagrams,
yes,
geometric and arithmetic diagrams. But these diagrams, they can sometimes have symmetries. So then there is not a canonical way to identify the left and the right hand side. And so this is already intrinsic, this ambiguity in this parameterization. And the same thing happens here. You because these automorphisms will preserve, obviously, the Poincaré densities. So you can never hope to distinguish parameters that are connected by these automorphisms.
Yes. But in fact, my question was not connected to this, but to the fact that the notion of temper, for instance, in this, as a for SO2 n plus 1, Neubla and Vascoli twist. In the case of SO2 n plus 1,
you can use
the yes, thank you. In the case of SO2 n plus 1, when Neubla and Vascoli compute the stable L packet, they twist Lustig parameterization by the Zelewinski involution.
Yes, of course. So you need to. So I am a little bit mystified about this fact. So Martin also told me Ross Berger has apparently found that Lustig had the opposite
of the expected
parameterization. Yeah. But of course, I want it to be like this, which was already true in the original Kasnan-Lustig classification. If you have a tempered parameter, it should correspond to a tempered representation.
Yes, but the
not
point
to
is
that
I think correct me. I think the Kasnan-Lustig parameterization does not coincide with the Lustig parameterization for unipotent.
No, because I know for the Kasnan-Lustig it has this property. So I am mystified why Lustig apparently decided at some point
to
don't know. But there is only one way to connect it. So that's the good part about this story.
Yeah.
So I take the original Kasnan-Lustig parameterization and the necessary dualities you should apply such that tempered parameters correspond to tempered representations. But there is only one way to do that, and in this sense I mean we take his parameterization as the yes. So the formal degree, in some sense, is the only invariant for L packets. But of course, the devil is in the details. So, because that essentially means that certain automorphisms we cannot distinguish, or twist by automorphisms. But, of course, this is not acceptable. If you interpret local Langlands parameters in a global setting, for example, and you look at the meaning for the, for example, the Arthur conjectures about the multiplicities of the packets, then it's certainly not allowed to change things by automorphisms at one local place. So this is a problem. I mean, so it is too strong to say that it is determined, but it's up to these twists, and they will create some chaos.
Among unipotent representations, formal degree determines the representation, because for GLN there are many supercuspidal representations of same degree.
Yeah, so it's only for unipotent that I am discussing. So for unipotent representations, the statement is that the formal degree is a very strong invariant. But if you go to cuspidal representations in general, then I think this is
For GLN, the representations of the same depth tend to have the same formally. But there are many.
Yeah, I can imagine. So this is something typical for the... So the hope would be that knowing something about generic supercustodial representations, using this, you can maybe say something about the residual spectrum in the Lemmon's parameterization of that. Because in this, so this unipotent representations are attached to the generic custodial representation of the torus, namely the trivial representation, right? And then all the, if you close it in some sense, you find all the unipotent representations. And perhaps if you take some generic type of greater depth, you still can do the same procedure. That would be the hope. And then in this, so then relative to already knowing it for these generic crystals, the Lemmon's parameterization, you can say perhaps something about these residual phenomena. Also, so here the statement is very strong that I need essentially a simple group, so adjoint type. But Mark Leader has extended the Lemmon's parameterization for Imahori fixed vectors to general semi-simple groups. And I believe that this theory can be strengthened using these methods. In fact, in the paper with Dan Shiwakawa, we did this already in the Imahori fixed case. And I think for the other Bernstein components, you can do the same. So I believe that I can even go to a general semi-simple group for these human components.
Number 2 is a consequence of number 1?
Well, that's a very good question. But that is also assuming certain standard conjectures. So that is in Langlands conjectures on the Poisson measure. Yes. So I don't know what the status of that is. Maybe in recent times this. But this was written in the paper of Hiraga Ichino and Ikeda, so it's not too much outdated information.
So what you said, to
prove,
to deduce conjecture 2 from conjecture 1, what you need about Langlands correspondence, what kind of property? LLC plus or something?
There is this paper of Shahidi, no? It's
yes.
On the conjecture of my friends. I I think once you know the formal degree of the inducing data,
yes,
then the contribution of the principal series to the natural measure,
yes,
is dictated by the factors.
He uses the representation on the unipotent radical of the parabolics from which you use.
Yeah,
and they are somehow exactly the complement of the thing that you use here for the discrete series. So you get together exactly the representation on this. But so it is. It should be contained in Shahidi's paper, what you need to make this strengthening of 1 into 2.
Are there no further questions?